Let's set the preface. Philadelphia has to win this match in order to have a chance to qualify for the playoffs. Shock have to win the match 4-0 to keep the 20-0 map streak alive. This match had the most analysts agreeing that Shock would win, but saying Philly could upset a map that here and there. But what happened was the Shock putting on a clinic and executing the fusion with isolation play after isolation play, and even getting value when they were put in a bad spot. When the first half was finished, people were expecting a rally from the Fusion to take a map, but instead, the Shock closed the door harder than anyone ever expected. It was just plain execution out of them. Welcome to Oasis University between the San Francisco Shock and the Philadelphia Fusion. Right now, the San Francisco Shock are in a 20 map win streak, so they want to keep that alive. This first fight, I'm gonna say, just got flubbed by Fusion really poorly. I'm gonna show you where it got flubbed and why. So, if you look closely, you see that the Winston is right here below the high ground, and that you want him on the high ground, that way he can just drop down pressure and jump back up. Same thing with their Lucio, he should be playing here so he can get easy ult charge. He's a little bit behind Moth because of where he was playing. Also, for some reason, EQO drops too and just plays in this in-between spot where he shouldn't be. He should still be up top, but apparently the Fusion just don't know how to play this. Oh, and another mistake. They jump in with the Winston even though if they were up here, they could just drop down and jump back up. So at this point, they've already lost the fight. It's just cleanup for Shock. Easy. Now, this next fight, I want to point out how the Philadelphia Fusion engage. They take centuries to do it. There will be a mistake from Sinatra, I'll harp on it at the beginning, but not that much. This per ally bubble from Sinatra makes no sense to me. It doesn't do anything because the Philadelphia Fusion aren't even engaging at all. But we're about to see 40 seconds just magically snap into existence. Okay? Reverse Thanos. Here we go. Just sitting around, ticking time. Tick, 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 tick. Tick, 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 you hate me, tick, tick. Still ticking. Still. When are they going to engage? That is the question. Oh my gosh, the Philadelphia Fusion have finally made a move! And, well, you know what rewards you get for making a move? Your opponent makes a mistake, and that grab was a mistake that just happened because you made a move. Congratulations, Fusion! You now have a chance to get the point. Congratulations, Fusions! You now get the point. Now, I want to draw a comparison here really quick with the way the Shock engage. We're already back on the Shock engage, and they're already on point engaging. Under 20% for the Fusion, and they're already engaging. That is beautiful play from the Shock. It's just beautiful. They don't waste time making a plan. They don't waste time trying to get their Zarya energy. They know when they engage, their Zarya will get his energy. That's how they play it. And now, at 37, they have to fully regroup. Let's see what they next take the next fight. It's already only 20 seconds later, a little bit over 20, because they do play for a little bit of early charge, but it's not nearly as much as 60 seconds wasted. It's just small, they're quick, they're to the point, and they get on point, and they start taking fights, and things start going their way. Well, things don't go so in their way this fight because they do get a massive kill here, and they're gonna slowly lose this fight. Now, I wanna point out that the mistake here is not fully disengaging right now. They have the tempo to disengage fully. Wait for their rascal to come back and then take the fight. But they get baited into trying to fight this when they should just wait for Rascal and come back with an ultimate advantage, which they would have. Because Carpe used his, they only have Sado's ult and Neptuno's ult for the next fight. You have an Earth Shatter and you have a Diva Bomb in your next fight. Let's see. Yeah, they definitely got it by then. So now it's just staggering, and the Philadelphia Fusion win the stagger fight. Welcome to How to Flop and Engage Part 2. Same team. So the Fusion are coming back on their Winston composition, and I see this as an error, mostly because of this bubble right here. This bubble does jack all, does literally nothing. And the reason why it does nothing as well, the positioning. I see so many Winstons throw down their bubble at this exact spot. I saw it in a Contenders replay, I saw it in some other Overwatch League replays. It's just a habit of Winstons when they're playing here to put their bubble there. And it's such a bad bubble because no team fights there. Not a single team. No team in their right mind fights there. So then this happens where Boombox, oh, it would have been nice if we had a bubble, I don't know, right here so we could jump and help Boombox with a bubble of our own. Nope. And so Boombox dies. Now Carpe gets cut off. Oh man, I really wish we had a bubble so we could bubble him and keep him alive. Nope. Oh man, we finally got our bubble off, but it doesn't matter. The fight's already lost. Oh, that was disgusting. Now, I will point out that the Fusion this time don't take nearly as much time to lose the next fight. Wait, that's a spoiler. Sorry. They still drag out the time to 30 seconds compared to 20 from the shock on their first. Here, we're going to be seeing a defensive lapse from the San Francisco Shock and how the Philadelphia Fusion punished that extremely effectively. So, we're going to be watching how Carpe plays here. Carpe makes a good play here, and overall, it's just beautiful. So, notice he notices Sinatra on the side here. Normally, Sinatra, in most cases, would be playing around flanking here and here. Why? I don't know why he's all the way over on stairs, but he should be putting bullets in here because this is very easy for his team to come out and rotate and protect him if he gets singulated out. But since he's all the way over in Timbuktu, it's very hard for his team to do that. This 5 meters or so is actually a lot of ground. It's an extra second of walking. So Carpe does the isolation and they go get the kill on Sinatra on stairs. His team can't effectively protect him that far. If the Sinatra was closer, they could have. But I really like that the Shock did not panic. They only used nothing, man. And Philadelphia only use Graviton, which is great. Now let's see how much time it takes the Shock to get the point to contest. Already moving up. They haven't used bubbles. Now they use bubbles, and it's not even, like, barely over 15 seconds take for the re-engage. That's half the time the Fusion took to fight. That's the reason why the Shock are the currently the best team. They're decisive as fuck. They make their decision and they stick with it no matter what. And that's why the Shock are gonna win this stage, or they're gonna be the best team in the stage. They are so good and so decisive. Welcome back, guys. So here we're gonna be seeing the engage on University, and I'm gonna pay attention to the Lucio play especially here, because you don't actually notice it much, but it's actually pretty big. So we see the Lucios are up top by the names of the teams. Of course, the opposite names, but yeah. You notice how they're playing up here? Them playing up here will threaten isolation plays on the main field of battle, which is right over this area. Being up here, if Super were to push up here, all Neptune would need to do is play here and get a boop off right here, and that's an isolated Super. Same thing for Moth. If Sado steps up. Now, we see a small whiff from Moth that could have resulted in a play, but doesn't because of how the fight's going. Right, a little bit earlier? Okay. So, as soon as Neptune starts making the aggressive play, you'll notice Moth whiffs his boop off, basically. He just whiffs his boop onto Neptuno, which allows Neptuno to get that knock in, but it doesn't go through the Zarya bubble. And Neptuno almost pays a price, but he doesn't. So we're back to square one. Neptuno knocks Moth off a bit, and they're just focusing on making sure that they're blocking each other's isolation potential and opening up plays for their team. You don't notice this much, but it's actually very important. Bubble usage, aggression. Tease, and then they manage to get a decent isolation, which forces trans, and now they're gonna play forward, but they're gonna. But oh my god, that's a big shatter. And then grav, and wow, that was a beautiful isolation play. I love the shock. I just want to point that out. The way they play, if I could coach any team, I would coach them to look like the shock, okay? The shock just play that well. Because this move right here really shows the quality of the shock. They create an isolation play, which forces a play out of the fusion, which opens up more potential for the shock. It's just perfect. Now, let's watch this through. B. Now they're gonna go get no EQL kill though. Yeah, they. Okay, but now they're back from the low ground. They're coming back. They get a knockout on Poco. They get the kill on Poco, which is huge. And now they have all the pressure in the world, all the time in the world to just kick them back. Really nice play from Shock. Nice, patient, forcing mistakes, and then exploiting it. Now, the only thing I disagree with is particularly the shatter right here. I disagree with that shatter because I think you can just get out of there and re-engage. Instead, you use it, you force your own engage. Yes, it blocks their attempt of an engage, but you have all the tools to block it. And if it gets hairy, your trance happens. Welcome back to university. And here we're going to be seeing a really beautiful grav engage. Well, counter engage graviton. I want you guys to look at the placement of this counter graviton and why it's good. He doesn't wait at all to throw down the counter graviton. At all, because if he waits even a little second, he can no longer throw it because Poco is going to be in it and he's going to DM this immediately. So he needs to get this out quickly and he needs to get it out in a really good spot. And this spot is better than any other spot because he can split the team like this on here and only one side will get the trance, which is this side. So they get to kill the Reinhardt and Neptuno. It's gorgeous and it's a super simple grav placement like this, which is perfect. Just a work of art, man. Just a work of art. Here we're going on to I believe, the next fight after the first grav. We're gonna be seeing exactly how the Shock take this fight, because it's again, we're gonna be seeing another amazing isolation grav from Sinatra. They get the kill on Neptuno. No, kills onto Lucio's are terrifyingly good because of one thing. You can always confirm the stagger kills afterward. And that's a lot of ult charge, which normally is really bad. And ready for the Graviton, it's coming up soon. Graviton positioning. Right here. This is gonna force people on the backside. It's gonna put Sado right here. And it sets them up perfectly to get a kill onto Sado, which is what they want. Also gets a kill onto EQL, but I don't think that position was planned at all. It just does. Now, Sado's isolated from his team, and they could have punished him harder, but it's hard to punish things like that. And now they also get extra time from the fusion because they need to retreat again, and now the fusion have to rush to point with an unfully respawned team. Now, Neptuno's on point, and he just gets eliminated. Poco goes, and now we're gonna see the Doomie. But they're gonna zone out this Doomfist extremely effectively with Rascal's play. It's absolutely nothing done. It's perfect. This team play is perfect, and this is why the Shock are one of the top teams.
Welcome to Hanamura. Here we're going to be seeing the Shock engage onto the Philadelphia Fusion with a really nice route from Sinatra. We see Sinatra go up above, and this is unscoutable. You're never going to see it coming, and they just play it here. Now, what I want you guys to pay attention from this engage is that Sinatra should be shot calling that they're going to go on Sato, who's on left of rock. Well, right of rock for them. So, he may have had a miscommunication where he said left rock, since this is his left, but in fact, it's right of rock for him and left of rock for them. So, if they all engage onto Sato, when Sato gets immediately hacked, Sato is dead. Sato, there's nothing he can do. He's just dead. But since they do get engaged onto the right first and then left for them, they get picked apart a little bit with health, and this happens. Now, luckily, they do have Troy, who just manages to go and get boombox, like right now. However, they're still not in a perfect spot, which they could have been. Another alternative for what they could have done on the engage is got the hack on the Sato, and then had everyone during this time move straight through here and take the high ground around the back. This will have the supports of Philadelphia Fusion rotate to the point like normal, and then they're in a really nice spot with the Shock on point because Sinatra could be playing on the backside aggression. The only risk is that Sinatra can get killed in that situation if they don't create an action. Now, we're even here, and the Shock push up, which I think is the fine play. Carpe was a bit low. But here I say you just get patient. But the thing is, the Philadelphia Fusion are chasing off Sinatra. And Sinatra is dead. Neptuno chases him down, and now the Shock need to get the hell out of here. They can't really take a fight here because, wait, can they? They might be able to. But you do see that the Philadelphia Fusion do throw some ults in, and it's two pretty big ults too. Sinatra now has a EMP set up, and the Shock are a good look because they have 5 ults getting up, and EMP being one of them, so that's huge.
The second fight of the match between the Philadelphia Fusion and San Francisco Shock on Hanamura. I want to point out the beautiful spy checking that Poco is doing here. That keeps Sinatra from just walking on through and getting all the information in the world. However, I should also point out that the attack path that the Shock are taking is really bad. They don't have a Winston, so they can't take this angle here. It's impossible because their Reinhardt has to go all the way around onto the stairs. So what they should actually be doing is a simple angle straight to point and getting a stun on the Sato and then a hack straight after that. And that's a dead Sato because he has his ult, but the stun keeps him from using it, and then the hack happens under a second. So there's that. But this engage is telegraphed as fuck, and it's bad because, well, now they just get the Sato ult. And that's an ult which they wish they had back. 2 ults which they wish they had back with Choi Hoi been doing his ult. But they could have gone straight to point, and if they go straight to point, you don't want to engage straight to point as a defense when they have EMP, because as soon as you go there's a chance that you just die immediately straight up because, well, you're afraid to use your abilities and you have to contest. You can't not contest, but you're forced into a really bad decision. You know? You just force the enemy to make a decision. Here, they already prepared to make the decision to just do this to you. They already made that. They knew that. Okay, this is their most likely option with EMP. Boom. And that's what they do. If you go straight to point, they have to deal with an EMP on point, and that's super threatening because you can just cut them out.
After the last fight, Sinatra swapped to Zarya here, and it's going to change how the entire composition plays because, well, they couldn't get Sombra to work since Poco was doing a really nice spy checking. Instead, here they just go straight to right, then to point,
after going in and dealing with Sato's mistake of pressuring up. Sato, I don't know why Sato jumped up when he needs to jump back here. I mean, I think he thought he was safe jumping up, but it's just not going to work when Choi even is a D.Va. So we go, we already are up a main tank for the shock, and they go straight to point with this decision. Now, I'd like to point out, Neptuno is on the right here. Wait. And it's not doing much. The shock have a really nice area. I want to point out this brilliant play from Rascal. Oh my gosh, it's such a beautiful play from Rascal. He stuns the bomb, that way the bomb can't move forward more. Because the bomb was thrown so it would end up right about, I believe, here. And if you look, Neptuno is going to blow Violet into the bomb. Which, so Rascal stopping the bomb because they were having time to set up and make a plan around the bomb causes that this play to happen. Now, Violet still has the trance, but they're still in a decent spot. As soon as the trance ends, we see Carpe blow his bomb on it, and it forces out sound barrier. Now, we should note that the Philadelphia Fusion are up in support hole. They got to use theirs later, so they're in a really nice spot. Now, the Shocks start to lose this fight, but something really weird happens. Neptuno's down, so the as long as Moth doesn't die, the Philadelphia Fusion cannot get onto Stagger's head effectively. And Moth's not going to die because, well, Moth's good. And so all the Shock are on the right side of point defense-wise. But Moth dies here now, so but they still don't have Neptuno, so it's very hard for them to actually confirm anything. And we see Sinatra putting on some pressure damage and getting some ult charge. So the Shock are in a good spot because they their respawns are getting back. However, what we're about to see is a very minute play from Carpe, which is actually, surprisingly, a tiny mistake. He has his grav now. As soon as you see here, he needs to throw his grav right here. Super is going to be moving forward. This grav is going to lock Super into this corner right here. The rest of the Shock are going to be locked in this corner. They can't support Super. Super dies. Super minute. Super hard to find. But it'll kill... Well, actually, Super's on the other angle. But it'll kill one of the Sinatras. Well, one of the Shock. Okay, that is... No, that's Super. Alright, that's Super. Yeah, if he blows right there, gets the grav off, Super would be isolated. And with Super isolated, you just get the kill. So, here he throws his grav to the side, it gets Violet support, which doesn't work out fully, but... It does force a lot of attention there. Now, Neptuno dies immediately afterward. Where the hell? Oh, this was a big play. It's going to show up a little bit later in the highlights, and I want to catch it because it's such a big play that you just don't notice that often. But, man, I'll just show it to you. It'll probably be in the beginning highlights, if anything. Okay, so let's get back to on track. So after Sinatra's down, the Shock are down quite a bit of damage. But with Neptuno down, the Philadelphia Fusion do not get his ult at all. So the sound barrier right after the double trances cannot happen for the Fusion. So they have the Philadelphia Fusion are down the sound barrier, which causes the Shock to have a really good spot here. Now, it's very important to note that... What's it called? Rally and Sound Barrier do not combo the best, but they do combo decently well together because you get the full phase of the Rally. So that's another 100 HP after the Sound Barrier. And with, due to where Super is, he gets in a really nice spot to punish the retreating Philadelphia Fusion, which finds him another kill onto EQO. And Sato is now on his own, really lit here. And all of the Philadelphia Fusion are backed into this corner back area. Well, the Shock are on point and controlling point. Which means that the Philadelphia Fusion, whenever they go on point, they lose lots of value. Well, not value, but a lot of resources. Wait a second. Is that choice? Yeah. Wow, that is so lucky. It perfectly explodes on the bubble. At the end there, it's beautiful. And it finds Poco, so it's not that big of value since he missed it a little bit. But it's value enough. And now, Neptune will hold Sound Barrier since they're already losing the fight. And Sinatra has built another Grav in that fight. So has Carpe. Here we see Carpe throws Grav right on the Chui Hui Bin and Sinatra, which is decent value. Where does Sinatra throw his Grav? Okay, but Carpe wants to catch out Sinatra, so he throws it there. But Sinatra is within support range of his team, so it doesn't get as much value. And Sinatra throws his Grav onto the supports of... the Philadelphia Fusion, so they actually cannot effectively get onto point and support their team. This is huge, and this is big brain. The placement here is top-notch. He doesn't go for the shiny play. He goes for the play that's going to win them the game, and that's what I really like about that play. In fact, most of the Shock, they just play to win, and that's what makes them really beautiful to watch. Now we have, it's all contest time for the Fusion, and this is over. Another huge thing is that they manage to kill Yukio before he comes out. Most players come out this side, so generally that's where teams line up their Zen. Like, if you notice, most Zens will line up here or in the middle, back middle. This is the better position because you get the line up here. The only time you don't see this is against, like, sniper compositions. Because you want to make sure your Zen is safe. So the San Francisco Shock are running a Goats variation, where they don't have the Brigida and are instead running the Baptiste. Now, this is a decent variation, and it's specifically defensively minded. And the only reason they can do it is because they're on defense. Brigida provides an offensive stun, but here, they don't need it. So, one of the big things, Philadelphia Fusion swapped to triple DPS with a hamster. And this is really big because of the crossfire that they're able to create. Now, I don't exactly know where Carpe is, but EQO is in a brilliant position because he just controls the top of the San Francisco Shock. Just spamming in. Oh, there's Carpe. Carpe's on the bottom left right here. Now he has a really nice Sonic, which allows them to get a lot of scouting info and allows EQO to get the kill into Violet. Now again, they're in the crossfire position. They're always setting up that small crossfire. Doesn't need to be a big crossfire, it's just a crossfire. And then beautiful shot on the Moth. Wow, that's beautiful. And that's the point right there. Now, it's important to note. It's important to note that they cannot play this composition onto the next point that effectively because the San Francisco Shock will get positioning.
Okay, doesn't want to look like
we're back
result,
here, and we're on to the second point attack for the Philadelphia Fusion. They have 6 minutes to get this point and get a time advantage in 3 minutes if they do so. First things first, I do not agree with going top right here. I think they should go straight to point. The reason I believe they should go straight to point, as I'll show you in a little bit. Wait for it. Is because Shock is top right. Them going top right is a mistake because they have to use resources to get this fight going in their direction. If they just have their Sombra player right here and the rest of them go straight to point, and they hack Choi Hoi Bin, this team has to drop to point, and they get EMP'd. Instead, they've put all the burden of execution on themselves, and it fails miserably, as predicted. If you go straight to point here, all the burden of execution is on the shock. And that's what your goal is as an engage, is to put all the burden of execution on your opponent. They have to play a perfect game, otherwise they'll lose. You're also behind an ultimate, so you want to minimize that value. So there's that. It's more reasons to do the ground Sombra. And yes, you could have it so Sinatra stays up top, but who cares? You have control of the point. He has to drop down eventually, otherwise his team just dies. Here, Super drops down even though he shouldn't. That's not his job to deal with that. Chorhuben already had that dibs. So if they push forward here, they would get a kill. Ikkyo is dead no matter what. But they would probably get another kill, like three kills here, instead of just Carpe and Ikkyo. On to the next fight. Again, we're going top right. However, now, they don't even have to worry about anything aside from this. They do an interesting route, which is one that is the third route of Hanamura. There's only two major routes, and this is the third minor. And this one is an effective route because you take the top and you're unpredictable. You can go in any direction you want. You can take top or you can take point. They decided to go take top bridge point, which is another interesting route. And here we see a really beautiful play from Sinatra. As I want to point out where Boombox is. We see Boombox drops oddly. I believe Sinatra noticed that and then throws this grav on to grab either Carpe, well, to grab three people, and it gets the one that's the most important thing to grab, well, second most important, the most important would be Carpe, but the easiest kill, and then Neptuno ends up falling into it, which is another super easy kill to focus down. And then they go and grab Sato, if they nab it, and there's no running from the shock here. They get the full stagger kill to get their ultimates built, because they killed Neptuno. That's the thing about Lucio, is if they die first, all the stagger kills are going the opposing team's way if you don't kill their Lucio. On to the third fight, we're looking at top left again. And we're going to see some really good patience out of Carpe here. He sees the DM, he waits for it to be over, but the shock already killed Sato, and they don't have to worry anymore. And again, Neptuno's down. They can get the stagger kills. And this is why the ult's economy from the shock was so good this last point. Is because it kept being allowed to get the stagger kills here. They get the full charge Zarya. Oh my gosh, that's value. I love it. Oh, so good. And Sinatra pokes out, gets some ult charge. And now they're sitting on 5 ults again. They're in a good spot consistently. And they are putting themselves in a good spot. Again, they're going top right. Every team goes top right. And it takes a lot to really get a team off the top right. Honestly, I think Sombra is extremely good here on this, because taking top right without having to force them on point and put burden of execution on your opponent is extremely difficult. Here, the San Francisco Shock Disc give it to them. Mostly because they don't want to use ults there, and they'd have to invest 2 ults there. And in this moment, we're seeing them just kind of sit up there for a ton of time. I want you guys to count how much time they're just sitting up here, okay? 2-5, they take it. Fifteen seconds later, after taking top right, they finally dropped a point. Nice job forcing the shock to do stuff. Good job forcing the shock to do stuff. Force the shock to do nothing. I love you guys. That fight hurts my brain cells, like my clapping as well, but not as much as my clapping. You, as a offense right now, you need to make sure they're using resources. Right now, you guys are just so focused on gaining resources, you're doing shit all. You wasted your entire rally, And you just sat around doing nothing. You're just smoking weed over there. The only person that actually is doing anything is Mr. Poco, and he's not doing shit. Boombox is just shooting up top, but you would have had that anyway! And then this happens. So, you're finally down, and then you're all getting thrown into this area. Imagine as if, as soon as you went, you just kept going. And kept going, and went now. They don't have ally bubble. You can effectively force them to use resources on super. You force your opponent to use resources. The Shock aren't going to use resources if they don't need to. They're smart, okay? Like, super now has ally bubble. And super is super lit. And you're forced to use resources now, which you don't have. And the Shock just played slow, effective Overwatch. And dragged this fight out. A fight that should be, like, 15 seconds long, at most, into a whole minute of you doing nothing, Fusion. That is some of the worst Overwatch I have... No, it's not the worst Overwatch I've ever seen, but it's the most useless. 15 seconds. Now, the Shock, 4 ultimates still, and you still only have 3. And your Brigittas are still on the same value as well. You're going to take top. That's good. And now are you going to sit here again? They took it at 35. 5 seconds. 10. Okay, guys. It only took them 10 this time. Were they... I mean, am I being arbitrary there? I'm just saying... They're doing bad for no reason. They should be dropping right about now already. They sent Poco out. Okay, I get it. Like, it just all got fire-striked and hit pretty hard. But they have to force resources. If they lose this fight now, they're fine. If they lose it quickly, they're fine. They get another contest with a decent regroup. It takes, let's say, 20 seconds on this point to get a good regroup in. That means that if you all die... You could probably get the regroup in. And then you just wait 20? Like, you're just wasting time. The core thing issue I'm seeing with the Fusion is that they just waste time creating a plan when they just need to commit to the first plan that comes to mind and get on point. And the coaches will fix these plans and give you better plans. You need to first make mistakes in order to improve. And they don't want to make a mistake. They're like, okay, guys, they have this. What do we do? Okay, we could execute this. Just make mistakes. Force things to happen. Force your opponent to make mistakes. Here, the Shock just win this fight nice and slow. Force overtime, and already have an advantage by overtime. It's not just lit, but gets support from his team, like a good team. Like... I mean, Poco, okay, he's running his bottom down, but there's a little ledge there, so Poco can't throw it down onto the bottom spot, so he gets, so they already kill him, and Sada just drops down over there and goes off because he knows they can't win.
Welcome to the next map of King's Row. I already have some footage on this map, but I'm actually going to be showing the San Francisco Shock attack this time. This is the hot take. So, if this ends up in the video, well, I think I did a pretty good job with this take. So, first things first, let's note out the compositions. The Shock are going to be running standard goats because they're a better standard goats team and they know they can run it into them. Philadelphia Fusion actually runs goats themselves here. Philadelphia is playing up. Now, I think this is a risk. Specifically because Neptuno has to block Moth's route here. If Moth ends up at this position, Shock can just run right through here. And if Neptuno fails to counter this position immediately, this threat is so massive because of the isolation play that
Sato is forced to play into. If Sato goes up, he gets isolated quickly and probably dies. Now we see Neptuno's already trying to cut off the angle. We don't know what's going on right now. Okay, he goes to the right. I think. Okay, he's still up top. But I think the Shock had an opening there to make a play like that. It's a risky play, but I think if they do it, they get over with it. Okay. Here, I want to point this mistake out, because a lot of teams would make this mistake with GOATs. They try to create a full, like, 180 arc. You can't do that with GOATs. GOATs can only go up to, like, a 190. Well, not 190. 90. Angle. And so, unless you're at a massive advantage of the fight, which the Fusion are not at, they cannot effectively do things like this. One thing I want to note here, I want to see what Moth does. Oh my gosh, this is beautiful. Neptuno needs to knock him off path, and I think he ran out of ammo, so he couldn't do such. I'm actually going to watch this again because of that. Boom heal, amp. It's alright. Yeah, he's reloading, and Moth gets a boop in. Now, Moth did not plan this. He just let it happen. And he was going to force boop no matter what. If Neptuno boops him, no harm done, really. And he's straight to point. His team's going to be reinforcing straight to point. There's nothing bad about this play. This is just making a play when, well, you can make a play. Now, you could say this set off tempo, but it really doesn't matter. They have Sato right there, gonna swing in. Yes, it gets him a lot of charge, but it's still a good play. And I would not penalize my player for doing it, even though it doesn't do much for good. It's simply put, it's the correct play, just barely enough time to do it because the team wasn't ready to counter it. And I don't think Moth was expecting to go through with it. Neptuno is a good enough Lucio not to allow him to do that. So here, nice thing about what had the Fusion lost is that they lost really quickly, so they don't have to worry about getting stagger killed. And they are already all at 6 and ready to recontest. Now they should be waiting here. They're in no rush.
Mic off. Mic on.
Oh my gosh, it's so annoying. Okay. What's nice for what happened in that fight for the Philadelphia Fusion is that they're all 6 already. So, here we're going to have the first fight, and... wow, this is going quickly. They're all playing right, which is the right call, I'd say. It does leave a lot of options open for the Shock, as they're also in a good spot. However, I will say, I think the Philadelphia Fusion's too defensive here. The reason why they're too defensive is because I think as soon as the cart gets to about here, they need to be engaging onto the Shock. Because once they engage onto the Shock here, it's very hard for the Shock to get through a choke this tight on two ends. If you can get that car in that spot as a choke, it's almost impossible to push through that area for offense. They have to take other angles, and it's weird, and that could be a really rough choke to take. Now they got the full cleanup. They used two ultimates, no, three with Super Zolt, to get a ton of value on the forward push. The Philadelphia Fusion used one ult with Boombox. The Philadelphia Fusion are in a decent position, but they still have to deal with the stagger crew of Sinatra Super and all that, pushing them back a bit. Okay, one thing. This, when you're pushing through here, you want to push like this, okay? You always want your tanks and supports on this side, and you want your Azaria pushing around here on this side with an easy flip over here if needed. You're always putting the right clicks through here, and since the Fusions are playing up here, you want to push them through like this. Why? Because if they get through here, they have the back out to all the way to the respawn area. Super simple. If they're pushed back here, you get full stagger onto them. And you can cut off their retreat back here. A beautiful positioning from Moth. He gives his support his entire team, the support. He can easily peel back, and he shoots over the shield, offering really good pressure. And overall, it's just a beautiful position for Moth. Moth is probably in my top three Lucios right now. He's extremely good. Now, Neptuno does get away... with a boot play here. I want to check this play in depth. Moth should see the play developing, and he should already be moving to counter it right here, and look back, boop that back, so that his team can get out. Super minor. We're talking on the minuscule level, but it could win them fights. They still do survive. Shadow goes down. They trade Brigitte's, which is a major thing because of health bar. Notice that Sato is lower on health. This means that Philadelphia Fusion is much more hurt by losing their Brigitte than San Francisco Shock. For the Shock, they got a bit off on Super, but it's not nearly as much. He's actually still has some armor. Sato doesn't have any armor. Troy Hibben is being hit to no armor too, but it's not that big of a deal because it's split damage and it's not nearly as important. Now, I will say Troy had been really overextends here, but he puts his bomb in a really nice spot because this forces the fusion to engage. I think I know that's why Troy even was moving forward like that. So fusion now has to engage into the shock. Now, they do a grab here with Carpe. However, Sinatra's about to get his, and Violet trances. So now, Sato gets killed. Because he doesn't have enough healing since they don't have the Brigitte gain her heals on him every 5 seconds. And this is setting them up for victory. I want to also note how the Shock play this. Note how I said that you always keep your Ryan and supports on this side of the point and your Zarya here. So Sinatra's trading over the sides like I said he would. And that's why you see that. I also forgot to point out that Divas are generally on ramparts, and that's another thing Troy is doing well. So Sato charges in, gets obliterated. Now, they've already got this fight in a really good spot. Poke Bomb goes through. They don't have a Graviton anymore. Sato's down, so no Earth Shatter. And, well, the Fusion have zero ultimates here. The Shock don't have an ultimate setup either, but they took the point and they're in a better setup than the Fusion are. Like, this is just putting on a clinic. And I love the way the Shock... position themselves consistently. I made a point about this, I think, with Vancouver. And this, if this continues, I expect the Shock to beat Vancouver in this playoff if they do this consistently, because they are playing so good. The reason why setting up onto this side is a bad, and I saw Vancouver do this, but it's such a bad play, is I'll go over this in the Lucio video, most likely. This will be a part of it. Not this clip in particular, but this will be a part of it. Basically, if the defense goes over here, you don't care. You can isolate. You can do a rotation stunt here, and they have a wall behind them and here are their two escape routes. And you can easily block this escape route as you have shorter to go to here than they do, because they have to go into a curvy room. And it's less direct. Let's see how the Shock are taking this fight back. Okay, so they just kept the point. They're playing up a bit. Where is Moth? Okay, there's already a difference between him and Kellex, and there's very, like, him and Slime play very much alike, and I think him and Animo and Slime all play very much alike, and I know why they do it. It's the most effective Flex Lucio playstyle. It's just most effective to play that playstyle. He plays a more aggressive Flex playstyle, in all honesty, and I think that's part of the reason why the Shock are looking better to me than the Titans were. The aggressive, flexible playstyle of Lucio gives them way more opportunities. Now, Sinatra does get his grav eaten, but it's not the worst thing in the world. Why? Because the Fusion are now using a ton of resources. The Shock used Trance already. Really? Yeah. Wow. Okay, so they're going to get grabbed and killed, most likely. Carpe, please don't use grav. Okay, so the movement here from Carpe is decent. This team knows it, but the move from Neptuno is what I'm going to actually harbor on. Now, I don't know why he's already reloading. He should know that he doesn't have that kind of... Actually, he probably thinks he has time. The Shock just play on a whole different... The Shock just play on a whole different speed level. Neptuno rotating here over is a big mistake, as he should be up either here, here, or with his support over here. I'd position my Lucio up here just so they can get drop-down plays and threat the isolation play, so Moth has to play a bit more defensive, and you could get some pressure plays onto Violet a little bit. But you're emitting way more pressure up here because you are probably going to Stat Banana and show a Stat Banana thing about that after this clip. But here, we're going to see a Graviton. And this Graviton could have been better. And it's kind of weird. But he, as soon as he sees Choi Hoiben over there... Choi Hoiben is out of DM range, I believe. I believe DM range is like 10 meters. I think he can thread the needle here. That's close, though. That is really close. I think he can thread it. He should throw it as soon as he sees Choi Hoiben over there. Move it, get the throw in right about here onto the support. Super's moving in already here, and he's in a jump, but that he won't notice that. He can't read that fast enough. So nobody can read that play fast enough, but he can throw it right here, right off the Zen play, because these guys are going to be rotating here. That's the goal, is to put your supports over here, that way they get the full on sight line here. If he throws his grav like here, here, he gets both support kills, and that's an easy fight win from there on out. But instead he throws it here, and he puts it onto Zarya, which is going to be nearly impossible to burn down unless literally everyone is already there. If he puts on the supports get burned down and you wins pretty quickly. You either get a Zen kill or a Lucio kill, and that's going to win you the fight. However, now, it's just clean up for the Shock. Huh. That's actually kind of funny. Welcome to the Stat Banana side of things. I'm going to explain why the Lucio position should be right here instead of down on the low ground where he was. Well, actually, he was just dead. Here, you get this entire area zoned when all... Okay. If you position your Lucio here, you get a lot of zoning done in this area. You can drop down and force an isolation play on the Rhine, so the Rhine has to be playing much more safe. Moth has to cover you a lot harder with his Lucio, so playing right here just shuts down a lot more angles. You could also quickly peel back over to your Zen, or even peel back to your tanks. You also had, in the game, they had D.Va up here as well, who should be up here because he gets a free shots down. And if you want to play really risky, you could do this. With your D.Va and Lucio, and just go kill a Zen, and then go straight back into spawn if the enemy team decides to pressure you. Because that was a possibility they could have done. But I don't know if it's the good call. It's just an aggressive call, which you can make if you're an aggressive team. Welcome to the Philadelphia Fusion's attack after a horrible defense. We're going to be seeing how they try to recoup their losses and get a good attack in. So their first bubble usage is really just kind of forced, and I don't like it. But their answer to that is to go straight into alley. Now, alley attack is really good for a lot of reasons. However, you do get a really rough time dealing with an isolation. And their way of dealing with the isolation, Lucio, was extremely good. And I love it right there. You see, Carpe, they have Carpe out go first with bubble active and just try to force Moth out, which he does effectively, which is really nice play out of him. Now he goes to top left, and then he can just gets a really nice sightline, as you can see here. The one thing I would improve about their play right here is having it so instead of favoring this side of here, which allows hotel open, they should all be favoring this side, so they should have their supports closer up a little bit. By only a little, not too much. We're not that bad here, okay? We're only bad. We're not that bad. So as soon as this rotation happens, they need to make sure that their supports are on rotation around the back here. As soon as they see them enter a hotel, they need to place them by car. Not behind car, by car. Like on top of it and such. That way their supports have open rotation to either left or right, depending on how the shot come out. This gives them... They also want to be three on point during this time, with their only person up being their Reinhardt and their Brigida. Since Carpe does not have self-bubble, his first priority should be to be on point. That way he always is giving them that taking on the point. But since he goes out here and tries to do this, they're not getting that triple tick on the point with Choi Hoi and Neptuno with Poco, Neptuno, and Carpe. Boombox should be on black already, but he isn't, I don't believe. Now they're all on point. Look at this. They're being attacked into. But since Poco got demacked, they're in a really bad spot. Now, how did Poco get demacked? I'm just going to rewatch this. Sorry for the NA. NA brain, okay? NA brain. And the Shock are kind of soft contesting. The reason that the Shock actually are even allowed to do this is because the Philadelphia Fusion are just being super slow about forcing point. If the Philadelphia Fusion forced point, the Shock would not do this. I know, he's back there. Where the hell does Poco... Oh, Poco! Who in the hell? I want you guys to watch Poco. He's other my right. And you just get bashed and killed immediately. Why are you there, Poco? There's no reason for you to be up here. The farthest up you want to be is a little bit back here. Like right where Carpe is right now. Right to his right. Boom. And you want and you're in a really safe spot there because Sato is zoning them back. I should also note, where is Neptuno? I don't know where he is. I'd position, so by the time that happens, Neptuno needs to be positioning himself right up here. He is completely safe to position himself on statue, and Boombox is now on point at this point. Sato is going to be covering this angle, and being on defense. You want to play this like you're on defense. And as soon as, Shock start rotating around here, Neptuno is already back in here. Like, there's a lot of things that you could do, and this fort makes it so if Neptuno's over here, the Shock cannot take this angle, because you get the isolation play straight onto Super pretty much instantly every time. Now, the Shock go around black, go on black side, and you have, because you can, I guess EQL likes flanking. Okay, I understand it kinda. He's lit, so he wants to get the pack. Ooh, Neptuno! No! This is too far of a distance, Neptuno. You can't cover this distance. Okay, I get the idea, but... Still, that's way too far out. I thought he was going for Ryan, but no, it's just Rascal. You can't cover that distance without annoying your shit, and he just gets eliminated there. The concept is good. The execution is off. That's all I'm going to say there. That's a decent concept, but it's just a bit too far. I know a lot of people are going to be hating on Neptuno there. The concept is there. The play is just a bit too far. Like, he needs to know that he can just hit... The goal is to just barely get over Rascal and hit him back here. Instead, he's still putting his jets into this direction until just now, where he's finally trying to get back here. He can't get back there. He needs to hit off and then just slow his descent down and then go back. It's just simple stuff that you'd learn on Winston, but he needs to do it here as a Lucio. Because this puts him in a horrible position now, the Philadelphia Fusion attack has flaunted. Now, I will point out, the way The direction that the shock forced them back is really bad. Super should be forcing in here with Choivin. Sinatra should be opportunity bombing here with Violet, Rascal, and Moth. Since they all go right, there's a chance that this kind of thing happens where they can't actually pressure them back because they don't have their tank. Now, Violet goes down because they get earth shattered like this. Actually, I should look back on that. My call was probably wrong. Now that I actually look up at the ults. Oh, no, it wasn't wrong. If you put Sinatra, Moth, Rascal, and Violet here, they're perfectly fine. And Super back here, kind of just pressuring them before it a bit with the fake play. Basically, what I mean is that Super and Troy form the fake play, while these guys form the brunt that's going to come in here. So you're put in between a rock and a hard place, this being the rock and this place being hard. And it's almost impossible to get out effectively. As long as Super and Troy do not cover this door. You can't cover this door, you have to cover this single door. So that's a mistake. I'm sure the shock coaches are already getting onto that. Because the shock are playing so well that there's very few things that they actually have to focus on improving. Violet goes down, which opens up Carpe's grab, which they use. Moth has to beat it himself. You see, Neptuno is flying in. Misses the beat. I mean, not the beat, but misses the grab. Because of the angle he's flying in and at the speed. He needs to get the angle. Actually, get the angle here, I believe. Actually, no, Super's... Super shattering? Or did he already shatter? Yeah, he already shattered. And if he does that, Super's dead, and I believe the other person in the ground is dead. Now, that doesn't matter, but that's the thing. Fusion should have never won that fight in the first place, in fact. And only because of a staggering mistake, the Shock end up losing it. Neptuno is controlling top left. Where's Moth? Where the hell is Moth? I need to know right now. Kind of surprised Moth... Is there a reason Moth isn't here? I want to find out this reason that Moth isn't here. I'd expect Moth to be here to force the isolation, then jump off. He has a jumping off point. Well, it's threatening isolation. Because defense wants to make it so this cart doesn't get through there because they want to give it a really tight choke for their Rhines to play around. Now Sinatra's down. And they're just going to lose this fight, no spending. I want to find out where the Moth was, that fight. Did he get some late spawn or something? No. Oh, he shouldn't. Yeah, he's out. He's out like Beverly Clare. There's Moth. Jumps out. Okay. He's out of dodge. Now, where the hell does he go? Where the hell is he? Troy's up top. Oh, there's Moth, but why the Moth leave? Is that him? Wait a second, is that him? Yes, that's him. I think the click. Sorry about this. No, that's Rascal. Oh, Moth is playing over on this wall. Okay. Okay, now that you got the kill, we play this nice and slow. Don't force anything. You could go for an isolation play, but that's about it. Really nice ice. Wait, I need to check back on that a little bit. And I'll point something out here. When you're doing a isolation, finishing stagger, you never really want to go back here, past here, unless you have a critical advantage. You never want to go dip back too far back here. Like, you want to go around here. This is your cap. Really, your cap is around like that. No, Sinatra goes too far to the right, which causes the death. Now, again, Neptuno! Oh my gosh, I love you, Neptuno. That was a really nice play. Neptuno, no matter what he does, is dead here. He went the wrong way, so he's out. He manages to knock Sinatra into the corner, which opens up the kill for the rest of his team, and that is capitalized. If he doesn't knock that Sinatra into that corner, well, they don't get the Sinatra kill, and they don't get the super kill afterwards, because the Shock would have already backed out. So that kill is actually big brain.
Come back to King's Row, and we're seeing this match between the Philadelphia Fish and San Francisco Shock. Right now, they're about equal in terms of ultimate prepare. The Shock are a little bit ahead, but not by much. It's not going to be a different matchmaking difference. Okay, let's see. I want to see how this gets eaten. Troy, where are you? Okay. Okay, so he just catches him out. Okay. He wasn't patient enough there by that little bit of time. Nice eat by Troy, though. So now it's just keeping it nice and slow. The Shock want to match him on the left side as much as possible. Get the kill on DKO. That's nice. That's just a really nice play. And Neptuno's down. How did Neptuno die? Oh, I see him in the corner. Okay. Neptuno's down. They should just continue. Just continue. Just continue. Moth, you need to be on the continuing side. You see Super's going back. You should read this and keep going. Keep going. Keep going with your team. And they get more kills. They still get the Zarya, but they could have gotten probably a tad bit more and a tad bit quicker. So, next fight. Okay, here we are. Reset. This fight, the Philadelphia Fusion have 5 ults, the San Francisco Shock's 5. Well, no, 4. So it's pretty even right now. Both teams have support ults with Trance and the Beat, but Philadelphia Fusion also has the Rally, which you're going to use on the engage right about now. Yep. So the Shock need to back up a little bit and keep it nice slow. They want to build their Shatter before they engage. And they're doing a really nice job building it right now. And then Troy can test, but he's going to go flying up to Ramparts and then moving back. And now they're going to have Shatter of their own. One thing I will penalize the Philadelphia Fusion for doing is doing another 180 here. They're trying to control all this aggression, but they can't do it with goats. You can't do this with goats. They should all be on this side, force the Shock to do this rotation. And as I believe I already have stated in this video, this rotation is very beneficial for you as the attack because it puts them against a wall. Well, I should say backboard. Okay, so with the Shock here, they're still just contesting barely. They're waiting. They're still waiting. They need the patience. They're cutting down. If you noticed, most of the rally armor is already gone. Now, Carpe uses grav here, and this grav position is a little tad bit off. If you look closely, this grav right here should be right here, because this will pull someone onto the isolation side where you can easily kill them. That's a reason I would put grav there, is it would not likely grab. I'm not sure. But I still think you wait to use grav here. Either that, or you grab, no, he has ult. There's no way you do that. Wait, Violet's on that side. Yeah, but this grab is still probably one of the least valuable grabs you can get. Because all it does is build EQO's ult, and that's not valuable to you. As valuable to you as these other ultimates that you can be,
killing them with an isolation grav instead of a ult charge grav. Clean up. So right here, Fusion have 3 ults to the Shocks, well, 3. They're equal in ults, and Violet's ahead of Boombox to get his with 60% while Boombox is at 40. So they force Choi out, and they keep forcing Choi into long, and then the entire team commits here when it should only be Poco and Carpe should be the only ones committing here, but I believe the rest of the team commits. And this drags out this team really far, as I believe Zen is still on the right. Yep, Boombox is still here. Neptuno's over here. Then you have Sado underneath. Their team's really spread out, and it allows the Shock to get a really simple engage, and it could cut them off from their Zen effectively. And Choi doesn't even die. So now they're in complete chaos. The Shock, due to a rotation, but the Philadelphia Fusion are no place to do anything about it because Sado's pinball right now. Sado's down, bomb's going in. Shock go into a small cover with Super, and there's nothing the Fusion can do about it. And now, well, it's Shock time. Clean up with ultimates. Easy game, easy life. Hello, my friends. This is going to be Junkertown, the final map between the San Francisco Shock and the Philadelphia Fusion. On this map, I want to point out one very important part that a lot of people are going to miss, is that the Shock actually never put their Bastion on the cart this entire first point. If you watch this, first of all, this angle for Bastion is just meant to cover this area. They're trying to make it so the cart just gets to here, and then they're going to move up the Bastion. They move up earlier, actually, because they already know that that area is confirmed. So they move their Bastion up, and they're using Violet as their second pressure, if you look. Now, Violet here is just going to pressure back the supports. That's his job right here, because the tank busting is already in Bastion's job. So he gets the Neptuno kill, which is going to mean that they secure all of the stagger kills. Well, maybe not the Zen, but that's most likely. Neptuno could take, I mean, not Neptuno, Violet could get that easily. Granted, even if he doesn't get these kills, the stagger kills are most likely theirs. And yeah, Boombox is dead. So again, we see that they don't even look at the cart, they just skip it with the Bastion. Their Bastion sets up, which I would say in a inoptimal spot, in my opinion. I have a segment later in the video where I go over this entire defense of how they should have correctly played this, because this was a tiny bit flawed. And this is the kind of opener thing where it shouldn't be flawed. Openers are almost always right on the dot. You can get that done as a coach. And the Shock's coaching staff is amazingly good, as we've already covered time and time again. They are stunningly good. Okay, here they do res the Bastion. He's looking around for a position that isn't where they were, and he finds out that, oh, I can be on top of cars. And that's where he goes. Being on top of cars is a huge thing. It's a really good spot because they can't pressure you as goats. They literally cannot pressure you as goats. And since you have a barrier in front of you, they don't have anything to break it. Or are they going to break it with Boombox, Neptuno, and a low-charged Carpe shooting off at you? Not going to happen. So now it's just about taking this nice and slow and getting the kill. Boom. And then he just can fire on here with this. Yep. Bye. Bye. Also want to point out right here, this is some brilliant play. However, I will say, this is not Sinatra's duty to do this. He needs to be getting into position, which I'll cover in a little bit, of how brilliant the Shock position themselves in this next fight. Because, my gosh, it's beautiful how they position themselves. So, as you see, they just wait here to get the kill a little bit later. They could have waited a second longer for when it said contested to kill her. Welcome to the step, and that part where I'll say how I think the Shock should have optimized their positioning on the first point fight. So here's what I believe they should have done. I'm using Doomfist as Baptiste since I have not updated Stepanana of late, so I'm on an older version. But this is what they should have done. Violet should be taking control of this exit a little bit, and him being here controls this sightline really well. When the Fusion start their engage going forward from one of these angles, you have Rascal go to here with the Baptiste, which allows him to shoot here, allows him to adapt to shoot here. It just has a really good area of fire and control. If the fusion go out here, then you have Violet swap to this side of the boxes, and you have Rascal taking this sight line. This takes a lot of space. This entire Bastion setup just shoots across here. It's a really good setup for the Bastion. Even back here, the only places where it can't shoot are here and here. So just, that's the only blind spot for Bastion. A little bit over here, but not as much. That's a very good Bastion position that you need to make sure that you cover through having pieces to shoot in this area and shoot back here. So no matter where the Philadelphia Fusion come from, you need to have your Rascal and your Violet able to rotate to cover that area. And this is the kind of setup that will help that. Also, you have Moth right here who can effectively go to Violet to support him if he has to go back here. Or even support Rascal. And you just have Choi Hoibin on the D.Va just to uncart and push it in. Because once you have this setup, it's really hard to break. If you're facing a sniper composition with this instead of what the Philadelphia Fusion decided to do with Goats, positioning onto boxes is the correct move because otherwise you just get sniper shooting from here to here easily from the high ground. And Bastion right here deals like 50 DPS at this spot. So that's why I think the shock position there is to make sure that they couldn't get ripped apart by snipers. But you do that once they actually swap to a composition that can do that. Otherwise, you stay in the cars. Other than that, it's still a lot of the same ideas. However, if they're in a sniper composition, I'd move Violet over here, and Rascal would be playing back here with the Mercy over here as well. Just gives a lot of cover. You could play Mercy here as well. There's much more variation. Choi is still on payload duty, though. D.Vas are on payload. It's what you do. So if you notice Sinatra is setting up on low ground, if he hadn't gone to kill the D.Va, they would have had Sinatra set up on high ground already, and Choi Hoibin would have gotten the D.Va. Well, Choi Hoibin is payload boy, and he deserves some kills now and then. But here we have Sinatra and the rest of the San Francisco Shark outside of Choi behind us, and we have Violet just setting up the forward pressure. They're going to be putting up the damage boost right in front of Sinatra pretty soon here. Yeah, right here. There is nothing that the Fusion can do, and Poco going straight after him is really stupid unless Poco has to... Because Poco just has to bomb now. He has to just drop down, and if he gets eliminated, he's bombing. And this is not a good spot to bomb. I'm kind of surprised he doesn't bomb in that position, in fact, because he went all the way up. He should have bombed there. It just, even though it would have gotten kills, it gives his team some valuable time. Where the Bastion isn't shooting on point. He's just taking it slow. He's letting his team get the kills. Like, that's the thing I would tell my player to do, and he probably wouldn't do it. But the Shock, they do it. They have the respect for the coaching. They're forced to have the respect for the coaching to do that. Here is another beautiful play that I'll go over and step in and out later. Its crossfire is stunningly good. And the way Violet is going to play this. Beautiful. Perfect. 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 The entirety of Shock's play is perfect. Now here, the play is a tiny bit off from Violet, but overall it's about as perfect as can be. There's not much you could do here. They finally got their ultimates. You have nothing in the world to stop that kind of ultimate play. The only problem here is going to be... Wait for it. Wait for it. Wait for it. Now, hey, by the way, I just want you guys to notice. Vape. This is something the Shock do consistently with the Bastion composition. They're always forcing the fight to be, well, in a really good position for themselves. Right here, so with the Philadelphia Fusion, the Philadelphia Fusion on this point, we're playing right here, and it's super hard for them to actually do anything against a Bastion in this position. They can't go here because then Baptiste just quickly ults. They can't just come up here again, Baptiste, quickly ults, and they just rip them to shreds. They have to deal with a Roadhog spam, Orisa spam, Bastion spam, which damage boosted, and Troy is consistently pushing the payload. Troy the payload boy. That's why he's such a good, like, this is such a good way for Shock to play. And can we please make that a meme? Troy the payload boy. It's just great, okay? Don't question me. But there's no effective way to actually get on top of Sinatra. Like, you might be saying, okay, they should be going around here and inside. Well, the problem with that is, first of all, they have to cover this whole entire distance. And Shock know they're doing that, so they're just going to rotate this entire setup all the way over here. And boom, you now have to cross this distance to get to the Shock. And that's just not going to work. And when you do that, you still have to deal. And Troy, keep in mind, the payload is moving this entire time as well. So, there's that. So you just have them, like, they're already up here. And Troy is going to rotate and peel back if the fight gets there. Okay? That's what he's going to do. He's just payload boy. The only way, there's pretty much no effective way to fight it outside of back here. This is the only place where you could fight that positioning. Because otherwise you're just on a ticking time bomb and you're just doing it for time. I don't see you winning a fight without good ultimates usage, because once you do get this position back and force it back, they can't really do an effective engage. So that's the thing. So let's go peel back. So let's go to their next point, which, because of things, is now, like, ahead of time, back in time, because of how I set this up. Here we have Violet playing on the upper dip, which is above the dip, and he is just applying pressure and threat for when they engage onto the Bastion. Mercy and Baptiste are going to be playing back here and damage boosting Bastion for when they engage. Shield with him, and Troy is still on the payload. Troy the payload boy! Let's go, Troy! I love you. Yeah. If you think about what this does as a threat, Bastion right here controls this angle, and a little bit into the dip, and all of this. That's a lot of threat that Bastion provides you. So much area control, and they can't effectively contest the payload outside of right down here. And the only way they can do that is by positioning themselves under here, which is in Violet's range. That is why the Shock position themselves so well, consistently. It's almost impossible to effectively deal with the Shock. And that is why they're a top contender. Okay, here, let's see how the Shock re-engage. Now, the Shock, straight to Goats right afterwards, which is really nice. Like, they are behind on ultimates, but they can lose this fight and then win the next fight. That's their goal right now, is to set themselves to win the next fight. Now, the way they do this, and then they get this kill on Neptuno. And I want to point out, Neptuno is a bit over-aggressive consistently. His Moth is aggressive. I think Neptuno should take some notes from how he played. Because Moth never really got killed in front of his team. Neptuno, I see it a little bit consistently. Now, it's not that bad, but it happens consistently enough for me to note it. I'm not going to overkill something that doesn't need to be overkilled. Okay, on to this next fight. The San Francisco Shock have now built enough ultimates, so if the fight goes long, by like 10-15 seconds, they'll have their ultimates up. And that's big. The Philadelphia Fusion only have 3 ultimates this fight. The San Francisco Shock have 5. Yeah, 5 ultimates this fight if the fight goes any longer than 5 seconds. Which it will, no matter what. The Shock are going to play it that way because they're well coached. Now, you see, the Shock actually do an engage here, and the engage happens quick, and they get this bomb off. This is the Shatter Bomb surprises me, and it's so good. It's beautiful. Like, and I actually think it got 4. Let me check. Poco. Yeah, it got 4 kills. Yuko got lit. And this entire value thing is just outrageous. And then we have Choihabin go up to cause some chaos. I want to note that Choihabin is probably one of the best divas in the league and should not be understated just how good he is. He's able to flex between the payload boy Choi the payload boy, and the aggressive Chad Choi in the GOATS comp extremely well. He does his job and nothing less, and I love him for that.
Okay, here we have the Fusion's attack first fight. I have a few notes on this fight, which I'm going to go over pretty shortly. So right here, we have Fusion creating a crossfire within two angles. And this is a decent crossfire. It's easy to set up, and it doesn't take much time to, so it's always going to be effective. However, there's one thing that they could do much quicker, and that is get the cart pressure going. EQL, Poco, and Sado need to be on the cart at the 5-second mark pretty much every time. That way they always have the pressure set up to make this crossfire effective, because if they can't get the setup going up quick enough, then Shock can already adapt to it. Now, let's see what else happens here. Follow Neptuno's positioning. Neptuno, being up here, as soon as he gets a boop off, needs a backup of it to this point. Because with him right here, basically, when Shock shoots up here, there's more threat in this area because of Neptuno and Carpe. And the hitbox is bigger because Neptuno is behind Carpe. If Neptuno is positioning himself here, there's a split here between the hitboxes. So it's much harder for Neptuno to die because they're going to be focusing Carpe first in most cases. But right now, he's just taking the crap shots that aren't hitting Carpe. And he just dies because of it. Then there's the engage, and it's an easy get engage for Shock to do. And they capitalize on it. Carpe can't do anything because they don't have speed, so he can't get away. That's just that simple. If I were running the play here, I'd immediately be saying Sado EQO down to a point, because no team generally will have enough pressure here as soon as you read the goats, okay? As soon as you read the goats, EQO goes to point. I get why they put EQO here. This is just a threat thing, but before he even gets there, he should know that they're playing goats, so they shouldn't do that. Like, he's already stepping back. No point. The drop needs to come way earlier. They took 13 seconds to get on point. That should be a 5-second area where they just get on point with their 3-point pressure and then get the crossfire being effective earlier. Because that way they're doing a triple threat. Right now, they did only like one threat move during that time. You need to have as many threat moves, but be able to support your threat moves in that area. And you could support 2 threat moves in a safe play on the backside with the Zen positioning. Let's continue into the next fight with Philadelphia Fusion flubbing another engage. I don't know why Sado backs up. I know why he's panicked, but he still needs to go forward. He can't panic. But the thing is, as soon as the Matrix goes up, the Philadelphia Fusion are not in a position to go forward anymore because Sado already backed up. And now, EQL, Poco, Neptuno need to get back into the spawn, and Carpe just needs to go die. That's this fight in a nutshell. And since they try to bail out their teammates with Sado and such, they die as well. Now here, they do a charge farm for Carpe to get the next fight going. Now, this is a meh play. I don't think it's as important as they think it is. As most coaches think it is, anyways. It's better to just do a full-on engage. Your Zarya will get full charge afterwards. Now, it just is 10 seconds, though. So I can get it. Okay. There's more behind it than I can just say right here, but yeah. They do a double. If you look here how they take this fight, this is going to be a pressure back. And I know that because they're playing on two ends. They're forcing back this side, and they're forcing back this side.
When you have two sides open, you just disengage in the center because you don't want the battle of, was it Thermopylae? I'm probably thinking the wrong battle in Greek history. The battle where the Greeks forced the Persians off that one island. And it wasn't Crete. But yeah. So you see here they have forced the shock back, and now we see this graviton about to come out. Boom. Graviton grabs nothing, but I wanna point out Troy Hyman's play right here. Troy knocks Sato into this graviton. It's not Sato's fault he's in this graviton, really. You could argue it, but I'm not gonna argue it here because I'd argue against it. Here, they force out trance, right? Now, so one, two, and Carpe's already thrown the bomb. At this point, the Fusion should just cut their losses and go back with these four ults and go on to engage the Shock in the next fight, who only have three ults. Well, only actually have two ults because they used three ults there. Think if they did that, they'd be in a really good position to go on and push the next fight. And map score does matter. Well, not score. Well, not map score, but map score winning these maps does matter. Hey, I mean, you put that end to the shock spree, which you get to be the named the team that put the end to the 23-game shock win spree streak. So there's that. But since you don't do that, also I want to point out how brilliant this play is. Not out of Sinatra right after here. So let's go back. Graviton. And now we get the Earth Shatter. Right here. I'm not gonna argue with the Earth Shatter that much, but I wanna show Boombox. He gets bubbled. Now the Chalk have to turn back. They should have cut their losses here, ditched here, went back, because there's no way they're gonna kill Boombox through a Reinhardt shield and a Zarya shield. So cut your losses here, head back. And go straight here, and you only lose Troy Hoyben. That's all you lose there. However, this is going to be bailed out by a brilliant play from Sinatra, who's going to throw the grav out, get the kill onto Neptuno, which puts them in equal fighting power, and they have their shield while the fusion do not. They're going to get this hit onto Carpe, beautiful, and boom, they win this fight. Sato's pressured back, and then just pew, pew, you're dead. Full charge Zaryas are scary. Now on to the last fight. Sorry, had to spoil it for you guys. The fusion go up top and then cut it low, short, and I don't like it. So the nice thing about what they did here is that EQL gets behind Super, so he gets a stun off, which forces the immortality field. I think Violet kind of panicked a little bit in trance when he didn't have to, but it's reaction. It's like something that you it's very difficult to do. Sorry about the dog, guys. Just feed them to them some charge. I'm fine with that. They're just gloating now. The Philadelphia Fusion have already lost. They've accepted defeat. Boom! It's over. There's no way the Philadelphia Fusion can even get to point right now. Wait! They do it! But Sato's in and they're all dead.
I really want to do this as like a career. As like coaching and analyzing is just I love to do it and I love to spread opinions and I love to argue. Well, debate, but we all know it's arguing. So if you guys can help me do that dream by liking, commenting, subscribing, and telling your friends about this, that's the most important part. Telling your friends to do the same. I would love that, and it would really help me get to my dream. Thank you for watching.